give a little perspective and try to frame my story. When I was about 17, I sort of rebelled against the preparatory school system that I'd been a part of. I was went to one of New York's more prestigious prep schools, and basically, by the time of my junior year, I was just totally uninterested in academics, and I really more rebelled against, you know, going to college, and I thought for sure that I could find a more suitable, more fulfilling, more free way of educating myself after college. And I was still interested in writing, and I had written for the school paper on my father's advice since I was a freshman. And by the time I was a senior, I was actually on the editorial board. So I was trying to maintain that. And just before my 18th birthday, also in my senior year, a submission of mine was accepted by the New York Press, which is a free weekly paper, sort of like the LA Weekly. And the subject of my submission was about how I was smart enough to not have to go to college, and how I had it all figured out, and just a very hubristic sort of rant, 1,500 words or so, and they paid me about $150 for it. And I wasn't sure how, but it sure felt like a validation of all my ideas. Like, I'm definitely doing the right thing if I'm getting paid $150 to rant about what a know-it-all punk I am, and they're publishing it. So therefore, I've somehow stumbled onto the unmarked, unpaved path to success. I don't know where it's going to take me or how it relates, but that's going to do it for me. And in fact, many of the people who were working at the press at the time did go on to some great success. William Monahan was a contributing writer, and he went he won the Oscar for the best adapted screenplay for The Departed a few years ago. A guy named Jonathan Ames came on a little after I got there, started a column, and now he's got an HBO show called Bored to Death. Second season just started. And my editor, one of the guys who received my submission positively, Sam Sifton. He went on to become the culture editor and now the Times food critic for the New York Times. And for my part, I had about a dozen pieces published in the New York Press over the next few years. And at the age of 27, I was waiting tables at a seafood restaurant in Brooklyn. But the other thing that happened right around the time that I was 27 and waiting tables was a hobby of mine, a pastime, poker, was developing into a full-blown phenomenon. Really, it was like more than a fad. It was just like this thing that came out of nowhere. And I realized that, a lot of the people, some of the people I played with and that I knew from playing in local clubs in New York City and up in Foxwoods and online, that these people were actually, making a living or attempting to make a living playing poker. And it wasn't even like this nebulous, weird thing. They had the knowledge, they had the information. And, unlike, just by way of quick explanation, unlike, craps or roulette or baccarat, where the odds are very much fixed against you and very much rigged in the casino's favor. Poker's a game that's played, with two people, or nine people at a table, but it's basically played, humans against humans. And there's, it's a live, sort of organic and ever-evolving strategy, so you can beat the game. The casino takes its piece, and they're happy with that, and they're happy to let you compete with each other. Blackjack you could also beat, but the casino won't let you play if you know how to beat blackjack, just to put that in perspective. So I realized that, poker was something that people were making a living at, and here was another opportunity for me to try to make a leap at doing something unconventionally with my life and trying to make a living doing something that wasn't part of the system or part of the system that I would was rebelling against 10 years earlier. And so December of 2004, I worked my last shift at the restaurant, and January of 2005, I was playing a high stakes poker tournament in the Bahamas. And more significantly, later on that year in Vegas in June, I made the final table of one of the preliminary events of the World Series of Poker. I had a small six-figure cash, which isn't a big accomplishment in and of itself, except once again, I thought to myself, well, here, I did it again. I must have done something right. I found myself again on the unpaved, unmarked path to success. I'm not sure exactly where it'll take me, but hopefully it'll take me there slowly but surely. And I really enjoyed first of all, the final table was televised on ESPN, which is good because things aren't real in this day and age until they're on television. And it was also something I could point out to my parents and say, hey, look, yeah, I'm a professional poker player, I'm on ESPN. But more as the game progressed, and really more what I got to learn was the sort of pathos and the the insanity a little bit of the game and the people who play it. And one of the paradoxes is, you know, you have to have a complete disregard for money in order to play poker well. And you have to be able to shut that disregard for money off in order to survive long-term in the game. And I had just seen so many, you know, throughout my years in the game, I've seen so many people destroy themselves through, you know, behaviors and peripheral decision making that was just horrendous and cost them six and seven figure fortunes in one night. And what I realized after a while is that the real name of the game is bankroll management. And it has nothing to do with your skills as a poker player. You can know the odds perfectly and know how to calculate them on the spot. You can know how to read people. You can know how to dissect betting patterns and all that. But at the end of the day, if you're going to spend your whole night at the craps table, you'll never succeed as a professional. And you know, so basically, again, I realized that the path to success in this sort of unconventional way was not just sort of like letting things just like fly and just seeing what happens. It was just a very, very really dull sort of reality that bankroll management is the way to do it. And what I really realized, you know, tracing my experiences back and trying to succeed in unconventional ways is that it takes a lot more than just one thing, and it takes more than even the sum of its parts working together. You know, it's not enough to just have talent, and it's not enough to be in the right place in the right time, and it's not enough to get lucky. And as many great people as you have around you who could influence you positively, they're not gonna take you by the hand and show you success. So it's really about working on your own game and working on your own ability to objectively analyze the things around you, and you know, never just letting life take you where it's going to take you, but really aggressively figuring out what your goals are and pursuing them. And that's about my whole story. Thank you.